We're going to have our next session, and it's called Defending Civil Rights, a conversation with Sherry Chen, Xiaoxing Shi, and Peter Zeitenberg. And many of you might have already been very familiar with the case involving Xiaoxing Shi and Sherry Chen, and have been feeling increasing mistrust between the United States of America and China. So this session is just for that. And I am going to invite also our great moderator. And he was born in Taiwan, is a physician, and he currently serves as the chair of the board of PAFMG, one of the largest multi-specialty medical groups in the US. And he has been actively involved in community service. And he is national vice chair of APAPA and president of the Asian American for Good Government PAC. He is a passionate advocate for civil rights, and he has won many, many awards and listened to all of them. For his long history of community service, he was honored with the ACS Silicon Valley Region Lifetime Volunteer Achievement Award and Top Community Dad Award. I didn't know there was that award. Dad Award by Building Peaceful Families. And he also got the California State Assembly Outstanding Leader Award. And lastly, he is the Hero of the Year by World Journal. So, wow. And he is Mr. Albert Wong, and he is going to be the moderator for this session. So, thank you, Albert.
Thank you, Narasen, for the kind introduction. It didn't have to be so long. We're kind of short on time. So, I'm going to hurry up and catch up a little bit. For the timekeeper, would you mind, because we changed the program a little bit, would you mind please signal my speakers at about 7 minutes and then at 8 minutes so they will understand the time is up. Back in March 1999, New York Times published an article about a Chinese spy somewhere stealing U.S. nuclear secrets. 9 months later, Wen Ho Lee was arrested from Los Alamos National Lab in New Mexico. 9 months later, he was released on one, admitting to one charge of misusing classified information, downloading computer information from secret classified computer into a non-classified computer, with this apology from the judge. Top decision makers in the executive branch have embarrassed our entire nation and each of us who is a citizen. An apology to mistreatment of Mr. Lee, Dr. Lee, as a Chinese-American suspected of spying, and after intense investigation could not find a shred of evidence for that. Today, forwarding 15 years into 2014, Ms. Sherry Chen, hydrologist at the National Weather Service, you would think a very innocuous job that would not touch national secret or commercial espionage issues, was arrested summarily right in front of her coworkers, led away by handcuffs, and she is here to share her story. You can read about her bio in the program book. I'm going to ask him to come up here to speak. Oh, Sherry, would please come up and share your story with us. Also, what you learned from this. Sherry is an incredible, brave woman. She's able to stand in front of you. You know, one beef I have with Wen Ho Lee is after he won that $1.6 million judgment, he disappeared. We couldn't find him anymore. But Sherry is willing to stand up here and share with us what she faced and what to do about it, and all of us can learn from it.
Okay. Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm so glad to be here to see my friends from Great Detroit, Boston, New Jersey, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Washington, D.C., and the people who have reached out to me from across the country. Thank you so much for your care and support. I really appreciate it. I'm also glad to be here to meet new friends at this convention. I'm Sherry Chen from Ohio. Some of you may have heard my story and believe my situation is unique and too remote to you. But the matter of the fact that is that it's not. I believe you can relate your situation, you can relate my situation your own in many ways. Although my life has taken a dramatic downturn because of a government wrongful prosecution, you may not have my issue, but we share the same cause if you are from China or associated with China. What has happened to me could potentially happen to any of you as well. I'm originally from Beijing, China. 20 years ago, I left everything in China behind, my family, job, and benefits from my work, and came to the United States. Just like most of you from China, I was excited to come to US to learn advancing science, to be successful in Korea with my American dreams. After I came to US, I started from everything from scratch and worked very hard to build my new life here. I worked for government for 20 years. As a public servant, I dedicate to my job and focus on my profession. I believe in American values and committed to public service to my nation, the United States. Throughout my career, I earned my colleagues' respect and made my contribution to the nation. But I could never believe that I would be treated as a spy and become a victim of government aggressive witch hunt for economical espionage from China. My life was immediately put into tailspin and carelessly destroyed by our government. I cannot forget the day, October 20, 2014. My life was turned upside down. It was a Monday, started as a normal day for me. I drove to work at noon. But once I got into building, six FBI agents who were already waiting there jumped on me and arrested me in front of my coworkers. I was then led away by FBI in handcuffs in front of all my coworkers. I was totally shocked and didn't know what was happening. The extremely humiliating public arrest was like a disaster from the sky. Just a day earlier at my annual performance review, my supervisor was giving me very high ratings for my contribution to the agency by significantly improved our forecast capabilities and much more. But I was indicted as a criminal in less than 24 hours. All the tragedy started from a false report from someone who said I was a Chinese national and collecting information for foreign interest. The misinformed spy tip-off immediately triggered a domino reaction among security agencies. For most Americans, due process means you are innocent until proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt and by a jury of your peers. But for me, I was treated as guilty without a doubt. Although failed to produce any spy evidence as is originally suspected, but the government indicted me anyway and with a severe charges of up to 25 years in prison and $1 million in fine. A month later, the government issued a superseding indictment and doubled the charge from 4 counts to 8 counts with no new evidence at all, but to respond to my lawyer's motions, thus pointed the government fatal flaws in the case. The government blatant use of power totally shocked me and my lawyers. After 2.5 years intensive investigation, found all the evidence contradictory to his originally the theory of guilty, the government finally dismissed the case and dropped all the charges against me just 1 week before the scheduled trial date. The charges were dropped, but the indictment had ruined my life completely. The impact can be felt in every aspect of my life. We suffered mentally, psychologically, professionally, and financially. My agency suspended my job immediately. Neighbors and friends stayed away from me because they didn't know I was innocent or not. I was held up to public criticism as a spy for China. Every day, my family and I lived under constant fear that someone could be monitoring us every move. To save my life, my family in China have to borrow money from many sources, including high interest loans, so I can have my lawyer work for me. I was forced into deep debt just to defend my innocence. And the nightmare is still not over. Not only my family is financially destroyed, my job was taken away a few months ago. Instead of issuing an apology, Department of Commerce terminated my federal employment based on the accusation that stemmed of the same charges that has been dropped. It's impossible for me to understand why the DOC is still on the wrong path after 4 years of mishandling my case. Is this to save face from the embarrassments of failed prosecution, or to justify all the taxpayer dollar wasted over the years? I don't understand why the government cannot admit their mistakes and be accountable for their actions. I also don't understand why the government has not apologized to victims whose lives and their families' lives has been destroyed. My life is turned upside down once again. No matter how much I wish to put the long and the tormenting nightmare behind me and move on with my family's life and my life, the terrible injustice I have experienced shocked me in terms of what I believe the country stands for. But I haven't lost my hope, a hope for justice, a hope for fair treatment. Dear friends, racial profiling does affect all of us. We all have a responsibility to end the unjust racial profiling of Asian Americans. We all should do our parts to make this land a better place to live, not only for ourselves, but also for our next generations. Thank you all.
Thank you, Sherry, for wonderful testimonial of what could happen to you even if you're a hydrologist working on the Ohio River flood control. Imagine your job as engineers, as bioscientists, academics, and God forbid in the national labs, perhaps in the FBI, in law enforcement, or even in the medical profession like myself, that trouble can just descend on you. Just 7 months from the time Sherry was arrested, one morning Professor Xiaoxing Xi, esteemed physicist and department chair of the physics department at Temple University, heard loud pounding on his door, and he awoke from his dreams, opened the door, and there are gun-toting FBI agents outside, who arrested him right in front of his family, who were just waking up, charged him with espionage, sending industrial secret to China, which later on turned out not to be secret at all, and all charges were dropped. Here is Professor Xiaoxing Xi to share his story with us.
Thank you, Dr. Wang, and I'm very happy to see so many Chinese-American organizations come together today to discuss the issue of defending the civil rights, and I'm honored to be part of it. And it's been a year since the U.S. government dropped its charge against me for sharing U.S. company technology with China. And every time I told my story, I had to relive the nightmare, and it was painful. But I see it as my duty as a citizen to stand up, speak out, and hopefully my situation can convince more Americans to join the fight against racial profiling. On May 21st, 2015, before 7 o'clock in the morning, I was woken up by loud knocks on my door, and the knocks are so urgent that I rushed to open the door without even fully dressed. Many people were outside of my house. Some were armed, and some had battering ram ready to take down my door. An FBI agent announced my arrest, and the other put handcuffs on me. So the armed agents rushed into my house, running around and rounding up my wife and two daughters. One by one, they walked out of their bedrooms with their hand raised at gunpoint. And I had no idea why this is happening, and I was worried that this must be very frightening to them. And my younger daughter was only 12 years old at that time, but I could not have a word with them. When the FBI agent took me out of the house, I had no idea when I would see my family again. I grew up during the Cultural Revolution in China, and it was not unusual at that time that people could be taken away and not seeing their family for a long time. So at the FBI headquarters, I was subjected to DNA sampling, mug shots, and fingerprinting, and interrogations. Later, at the U.S. Marshals Service, I was ordered to strip naked and bend over the wall so that a U.S. Marshal could inspect whether I have hidden anything in my body. At the end of the two-hour interrogation, the FBI agent told me that I was charged for having made a pocket heater covered by a non-disclosure agreement with a U.S. company with my Chinese collaborators. To that I said, that's absurd. The fact is, I have never shared the pocket heater information with anybody in China. I could not believe how they could charge me and use these techniques for violent criminals and designed to inflict maximum psychological damage to my family and to myself without a thread of truth in their accusation. There were four counts in the indictment against me based on four emails that I sent to my collaborators in China. None of the emails talked about the pocket heater at all. A heater is a device that we use to heat the substrate when we make a thin film material, much like using a stove to for cooking. The pocket heater is a kind of a heater that was invented in the 1990s, and the U.S. company modified it for its own purpose. It is not classified, not sensitive, but rather well known publicly. And I'm not aware of any economic value it has to the U.S. company. I don't know why the U.S. government should even care about it. The FBI agents did ask me a lot of questions about my academic collaborations with Chinese colleagues. But these are what the U.S. government and the universities encourage us to do. They are for advancing science and for publications and never for any financial gains. And I have never done research that involves sensitive, classified, or protected information or export control technologies. So I was very fortunate to have engaged a team of great lawyers led by Mr. Peter Zeidenberg, and leading expert in my research field wrote affidavits to affirm the fact that I have never shared the pocket heater technology with anybody in China. The author of one of the affidavits said that I'm very familiar with this device as I was one of the co-inventors. So armed with these affidavits, my lawyers gave a presentation to the government and made a request to the government, find your own expert and ask them if there is any evidence that Professor Xi shared the pocket heater information with people in China. We have also shared with the government a motion to dismiss the indictment that we were ready to file with the court. On September 11, 2015, the deadline date, the court has ordered us to file our motion. The government dismissed the case, citing additional information came to the attention of the government. So when the case was dropped, and I told a New York Times reporter that the government should not have charged me without first checking with the expert. I said this is not a joke, and this is not a game. Just imagine that one day I was a respected researcher and department chair and enjoy family life just like any ordinary American family. Overnight, I was painted as a Chinese spy all over the news and the internet and faced the possibility of up to 80 years in prison and $1 million fine. Friends and the colleagues stopped talking to us and I could not talk to my students. We were constantly concerned about the FBI surveillance and even our personal safety. This sudden strike was enough to crush anyone, but even worse, the daily stress as time wore on would accumulate and become almost unbearable. And you know, we were consumed by outrage and anguish, defiance and scares, and it's really a nightmare that I do not wish to see any innocent American to go through. So, in addition, we don't know how to pay the mounting legal fee if the case dragged on. So some say that with mounting economic espionage from China, this kind of a false positive are inevitable. I would answer with a quote from the Supreme Court Associate Justice Louis Brandeis. The greatest danger to liberty lurks in the insidious encroachment by men of zeal, well-meaning but without understanding. So the cases like mine, like Sherry's, do not advance the cause of fighting economic espionage and protecting our intellectual properties. They undermine people's confidence in America's justice system, and they terrorize the Chinese-American community and scientific community. And in the words of the Associate Justice Louis Brandeis, they endanger the liberty that we cherish so much in this country. So the man of zeal in my case obviously were without understanding. But whether they were well-meaning have been questioned by many people. The federal prosecutors dropping charges is extremely rare. The frequent cases that scientists of Chinese origin being charged only for the charge to be dropped have prompted many to ask whether the racial profiling had played a role in these cases. And people like members of the U.S. Congress, the U.S. Commission on Human Rights, and the many Chinese American advocacy groups have asked the Department of Justice to investigate. And are Chinese Americans automatically suspected of stealing secrets for China just because of our ethnicity? Right. If true, this kind of a practice infringes on the constitution rights of Chinese Americans of due process and equal protection. So the scary lesson, like what Sherry just said, from these cases, is that such wrongful prosecution could happen to anybody. I did not do anything wrong, but that did not prevent me being charged. And I still don't know why I was targeted. And what it means is that no matter whether you are from Taiwan or from the mainland, whether you are first generation or third generation, or scientist or non-scientist, no Chinese American can assume immunity just because you did nothing wrong. So I would say that everybody has to be prepared for the day when the FBI agents come knocking on your door. And you have to think about how to find the right lawyers, how to get your finance together to pay the legal fee when this does happen. However, I think as a community, our Chinese Americans should and can do better. We should join major Chinese American organizations in demanding that the government investigate whether racial profiling has played any role in these cases. And like signing the petitions, for example, Asian Law Caucus has been promoting. And if it did, then we should speak up loud and clear against it. So last point I want to bring up is that fighting racial profiling is not a Chinese-American issue. Racial profiling infringes on the constitution right of all Americans. So we should fight racial profiling alongside all victims of it and alongside all Americans. So I would like to borrow a famous Martin Niemöller quote and rewrite it to describe the peril if we don't fight racial profiling and win over it together. Right? First, it targeted the African Americans, and I did not speak out because I was not an African American. Then it targeted Latino Americans, and I did not speak out because I was not a Latino American. Then it targeted Muslim Americans, and I did not speak out because I was not a Muslim American. Then it targeted me, and there was no one left to speak for me. So if you don't want the tragedy that happened to me to happen to you, we all need to speak out together against the injustice of racial profiling. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Xi, for delivering a wonderful speech and warning all of us this can happen to any of us, and the importance to form coalitions like the last panel has mentioned. We are just, I mean, within the WeChat world, we think we're really strong, but outside of Chicago, San Francisco, LA, and New York, we have very little power of any kind. So this is a, let me see, this is a call for stories. So Asian American Advancing Justice and Asian Law Caucus has asked our community to provide them with stories. You know, if these two cases did not happen side by side, we may have never heard about it. One mistake may be considered a mistake, two of them in such a short time, and there were a few others that we did not bring up today. Means there's a pattern, and that pattern, the common thread between a hydrologist in Ohio working for the government and the physics department chair at a university, there are not many similarities other than what they look like. And most of us in this room look like that, so to keep that in your mind. Fortunately, both of them found good legal help and they were able to win their battle. Since Wen Houli, I was part of the Wen Houli Defense Fund people, and because of the nationally known case, people have sought me out along with others whenever they face injustice. There have been numerous cases during these years, and we did not have the resources to help many of them. Most of them lingered in jail and finally decided to plead to some minor charges just to get out of jail, but there was their life ruined, even though their espionage charge was never carried out, was never proven. So they did not have the proper legal help, I believe, or the resources to fund the legal help. Next panelist is Mr. Seidenberg, who is an experienced defense lawyer, formerly a prosecutor for the federal government. He defended both Sherry, as well as Xiaoxing, and some other cases under his care. So we're going to ask Mr. Zeidenberg to enlighten us on how to avoid these cases and what to do if you should face such a charge out of nowhere. Thank you. Mr. Zeidenberg, please.
Good afternoon, and thank you for having me. It was a pleasure to represent Sherry and Professor Shi, and having innocent clients is a great way to make a lawyer look like he knows what he's doing. But to your comment or request that I give advice or suggestions on how to avoid have this happen to you, I don't have any such advice. Professor Shi did not do anything that even in retrospect was foolish or he should have regretted doing. Same with Sherry. And these cases are unfortunately not aberrations. I've represented Sherry and Professor Shi. I've had other such cases, including a case that's going on right now in the Eastern District of Tennessee. A Chinese American, actually Taiwanese American, although the government has indicted him and claimed he is Chinese American. I don't think they really care about the difference. It's close enough for them. And they have indicted this gentleman who's a nuclear engineer by the name of Alan Ho, and accused him of giving nuclear secrets to China. It's a case that has no more merit than the cases against Sherry and Professor Shi. He was assisting civilian nuclear power plants in China, and they are treating him as if he was trying to give the secrets to a nuclear bomb to an enemy nation, and of course China has a nuclear bombs already and has had them for half a century. And they are threatening my current client, Mr. Ho, with a life sentence. And he is sitting today in solitary confinement in a prison cell in Tennessee. And he has been locked up like that for almost 5 months without an ability to do anything, read, no television, no radio, no phone, no opportunity to speak with counsel. And I bring that up just to unfortunately underline the gravity and the seriousness of this situation. I don't consider myself an alarmist, but I also think you have to be realistic. And if this is not a pattern, I don't know what is. The fact is, our Department of Justice considers China as a very serious threat, and anybody who's Chinese American and has any contacts with mainland China and is involved in anything high tech, they assume the worst. I have another case involving Chinese Americans who are alleged to have committed economic espionage, and they are in the pharmaceutical industry. And our investigation has shown, just like it did in Professor Shi's case, that nothing that these individuals provided to China, every bit of it was publicly available information, and we've shown them where this information is available on the internet to anyone who is looking, or in patents. And the government, unfortunately, unlike in Professor Shi's case, now they're dug in because I think they felt embarrassed by the media attention that they received by those what were perceived as real black eyes. So despite the fact that they have nothing, we believe, in real evidence, they won't stop. The first thing the prosecutor told me in the case in Tennessee is they weren't going to dismiss this case. That was the first thing out of his mouth. So it's, you know, I wish I had better news or more encouraging information, but it really is I think, a very scary time if you're Chinese American and interact in these industries, which I know a huge percent of Chinese Americans do, who are working in the sciences or the pharmaceutical industry, computer industry, high tech, aviation, physics. Our government views that as apparently inherently suspicious, and they arrest first and ask questions later. And it was the first thing they did with Sherry and Professor Xi. It's what they did with this case and this other case I have in Philadelphia involving economic espionage. It's what they did at the case in Tennessee. They arrest first, they execute search warrants, and then they'll listen to explanations, although at this point their minds are closed. So it's unfortunate, it's grim, and it's scary. And you know, as far as what to do if you are contacted, you know, the fact is speaking to the government unfortunately is not a great idea, and that you should exercise your constitutional right, thank them politely for their opportunity to speak, and say you'll do so at a later time when you have counsel. Hopefully they'll respect that request, but you should make it, and then get good counsel. And I'll be available for questions after. Thank you.
Thank you. Indeed, it's grim news that there's very little we can do just because of the way we look in today's hostile environment toward Chinese Americans in this country. We all take extra precautions, but I want to reemphasize what Mr. Zeidenberg just said. If FBI comes knock on the door, thank them for the opportunity to talk, get a lawyer before you speak a word. If you remember, they're expert in getting words out of you of what they want, and they will ask all kinds of things until they get an answer that's maybe halfway incriminating and use it against you later. Have a lawyer around before you speak at all. We've made some progress, having Congressman Ted Lieu, Judy Chu, and others have helped, much more than we had when Wen Ho Lee was arrested back 16 years ago. Ted Lieu particularly led an effort to question the Department of Justice regarding racial profiling, and they have heeded that pressure from Congress, and they have indeed changed some rules. Previously, the local U.S. Attorney's Office, sort of like the district attorney for the U.S. government, the federal government, can charge someone and arrest someone on these cases. Now they are required to send these cases up to D.C. to the Department of Justice, where there is much more expertise to review before they act. That would be very important if they will only look at the pocket heater, supposedly pocket heater, and have an expert at the higher level of government instead of some eager agent who wants to make news and want to be the hero who arrested a Chinese spy just going out and ruining somebody's life. That is very important progress, but it's a far, far away from what we can get. I think the most important to me that to stop this is find the person responsible and get after them, whatever that may be. And the next guy who tries to do this will think twice, whether it's a lawsuit, whether it's a demotion, whether it's some kind of reprimand, whether it's being transferred to some lesser office, whatever that may be. Because without recourse, without something happening to someone who's doing this, it will just keep happening. No one would take notice. Like I think one of the panelists before said, you pick on the weak, right? Peter Liang was charged because, you know, I figure nothing will happen if we do something like that. So not a reason for us to stay active. Let's thank Sherry and Professor Xi for being so courageous and come here and share with us their story. And I also have great news for Both of them are under financial strain, by the way. Legal help is expensive. Finding evidence and expert testimony is very, very expensive. Both of them own hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt, particularly Sherry, who also lost her job, and she's the only breadwinner in the family. So if you can support them in some way, it is very much welcome. To that end, I would like to invite Mr. Ji Su to come up, and he's presenting a check from NCCA to to Sherry Chen's defense fund. Is that correct? Please come up.
We'll have questions. Let me do this. First, I'd like to thank Sherry Chen and Xiaoxin Xi for sharing their experience very bravely with us. And I'm Ji Su here on behalf of the NCC and the UCA. I will present a check of only $1,800 to Sherry, showing our support to her. This is a donation we received for Sherry from Virginia Peninsula Chinese American Association, a very small organization from my local. And it might be just a very small check. However, it's very significant because it is the first donation we have our legal defense fund has received. And I know this is just a start. I believe more support from you and your friends will keep coming in the future. And I'd like to thank you very much in advance. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Su, and thank you for the UCA Legal Defense Fund. Now we can open for question and answer. Sir?
Yes, I have a question. I respect the story, very moving. Question is whether you think to file a litigation case against the U.S. government for their wrongful arrest, the wrongful allegation, wrongful indictment. Finally, since the case has been dismissed, why do you file a case asking for government compensation for you? For the question for three of you, thank you.
Okay, for me, just exactly one year after my case was dismissed and all the charges were dropped, the Department of Commerce terminated my employment with no good reason. And the claim terminated my employment to promote the government efficiency. But just a day before I was indicted, my supervisor was praised me for significantly improved our forecast capability and the government efficiency. And I received that type of a rating year after year for more than 20 years. And now they claim to terminate my job to promote government efficiency. This is just like there are no good reason, just exactly 1 year later. I could walk away, let's say, to find another job. But I cannot do this. Just like if they charge you, like they want to put me in prison for the rest of my life, should I just go with it? I didn't do anything wrong. I haven't done nothing wrong. They cannot just punish the innocent people. And so now they fired me from the job I love. I know we have millions of people along the Ohio River Valley. They are now they are using my model, the model I developed, to protect the property and save people's life. I cannot walk away just because the government done something wrong and I didn't. So I have to get my job back and get my life back. I have a filed appeal to the government wrongful termination. But as I was a federal employee, I have to go through, have to exhaust the administrative procedures. That means first I have to go through the EEO process, to let them to go to do the investigation. Then later I have to follow the step before I can jump out of the Department of Commerce to do anything. So I'm in the EEO process right now. I have filed a miscomplaint for the government wrongful termination.
Thank you. Miss?
Yes, thank you so much, Mr. Wang. So, and thank you so much, Ms. Chen and Dr. Xi, for your wonderful experience. I know it come from the tragedy, but I really admire the spirit and the power that you bring to the rest of the community. So as an international student in the PhD program of American Studies at University of Maryland, which is a local university, I feel really honored to have a chance to listen to your stories and then learn the lessons. However, many of my fellow students who come from China who are in the STEM majors, they don't have a luxury or any opportunity to listen to this kind of stories and learn the lessons from the very beginning in order to prevent it. So is there any way that both of you or the foundation can do something to educate the students from the very beginning before they even go to a job market to prevent this kind of tragedy in the future? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. Go ahead.
Yes, we would love to. But by the way, what I'm doing right now, I said I didn't walk away because I don't want this happen to other, any other Chinese American or Asian American or any innocent people. So I want to stand up for the fight. I want just to make sure the government learn a lesson from this and they shouldn't do this to any other people. You know, you had a wrongful prosecution. Then after all the case are dropped, all the charges are dropped, but you still don't get your life back. This is wrong, this shouldn't be that way. My life, you know, is turned totally upside down. And now, you know, I have to suffer and have lost my job. This is not the way it should be. So we don't want this happen to anyone and our next generation. So we have to do our parts. And I want to do my parts to, you know, to fight for the justice, for fair treatment. And so I would like to do, you know, my part to help the community. Anything you need, I can help, I would like to do it.
Thank you so much. So, actually, both of them have been traveling the country giving their story. Committee of 100, which is made up of about a little over 100 Chinese American, very prominent Chinese Americans, and Professor Frank Wu, who spoke earlier today, is the chair of that committee, provides legal people to go to places to discuss this issue on their dime. So it's free to your organization if you can organize a group of people together. Papa and Committee 100 held one for Sherry back in last year and earlier this year in Palo Alto, and Brian's son, who was Wen Ho Lee's defense lawyer, came and spoke about that. So for all of you who come from all over the country, feel free to contact Papa or Committee 100 or Sherry or Professor C. They are very happy to provide this information. They're out here dedicated to pass on this information to everybody, and especially Chinese Americans. And sir?
Thank you for sharing your experiences so that we don't have to get into the same challenging positions. I want to ask a question, but I will share my personal experience of actually my father, 80-year-old retired man, went to a bench sitting there in a park next to a highway, and five kids, all boys, playing the basketball court. There are brothers and cousins. And one seven-year-old boy sit next to my father, and my father was trying to practice his English, so patted his head, asking, how old are you? What's your, you know, are you a boy or girl? Just whatever limited English he had. And touched his knee, and then the boy left. And then my father was arrested a few days later and took all the, you know, normal procedures of a person to be arrested, and then went through a public prosecution process, and the first notice from his charges, 50 years in prison, first degree sexual harassment. And you know, I know my father, so there's no way he does anything to a boy of a 7-year-old in front of his 4 siblings that are high school strong boys, you know. And in a public park next to a highway, a lot of people in rush hour coming back and forth. But the government spent, I'm sure, over $100,000 to hire expert, to hire psychologists, to hire neurologists, to hire translators, about 10 court appearances and a lot of legal proceedings of 2 years process. And I thought I would hire a lawyer, but then I realized that, you know, he's 80-some-year-old. If the government wants to take care of him for 24 hours a day, maybe it's no big deal. So I hired a public defendant. And the public defendant was a very good, very qualified lawyer, and he didn't charge me a penny, and get my father's case dropped. So just want to share that with you. But if that happens to any of us, don't be surprised. It could happen, because my father was playing in a park that's predominantly white community. The kids never saw older, oriental-looking men. So it was, of course, suspicious.
Thank you. Yeah, we're running a little bit short of time, so if you could keep your questions relatively quick and the answer quick. Here, ma'am.
I'm Monica Yung Arima. You can find me on your WeChat group. I help Sherry to do fundraising, and if anybody wanted to have her go to your city to share her story to your people and help her to fundraise for her defense fund, contact me. Or you can Google Sherry Chen Defense Fund to learn more about the stories. There have been many stories, including Channel 6, you know, 60 Minutes, New York Times, Mercury News, Chinese newspapers, articles, and stuff like that. So let me know if you wanted to help. And if you Google Sherry Defense Fund, you can get to her, Sherry Chen Defense Fund, you can get to her website and help donation online as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Monica, doing good work. Also on Professor Xi's behalf, there is a petition online that I think, Mrs. Xi, you have some material over here about how to get on the online to send to sign this petition and pass it on to your friends. The more pressure we can apply, the better. Thank you, and sir.
First, thank you everybody for sharing your story. I just want to provide 2 reasons I think that are relevant to this and why Chinese Americans are treated differently. Not 2 reasons, sorry, 2 consequences. One is it is very disturbing to all of us, and it will affect all of us. For example, one time I asked a non-color person, so you know what's the background of the person, I asked, who do you think I'm representing? He said, you are representing Chinese government. You're representing China for sure. Then I asked him another question, who do you think my child who was born here representing? I was suggesting US, right? American citizen. Then he said, of course China, he looked like Chinese. I would think he would represent China. So this related to all of us in this way, that everybody here associated with China in any way will be considered as representing China. This is very scary. So the second consequence is, this is terrifying. So what I feel is like at work, as a technology, you know, professional, whatever we do has some sort of, you know, high tech related to China, right? For example, whenever you're using, you know, storage, like a Baidu, they have a very good storage for you to use, but you cannot use it. If you use it, you share something on the cloud, even though it's very secure, they consider that you are transmitting, you're sending something to China. Is that terrifying? That's very terrifying. If you're using WeChat at work, nothing happens, you're fine. But if anything happens to you, they will dig into your mobile phone and find out, oh, you said something about this company, about the organization, to a person in China, they will go after you. So my question in the end is, what can we do? What are our choices when it comes to technology related to China, or when we collaborate with coworkers in China in some way? Shall we stop doing this, or shall we make some wise choices, and what are the ways to do that? Thank you.
Yes.
Maybe I can answer to that. And I think what you are saying is very true. And also, I will say that that's not too much different from, let's say, an African American driving a car, missing a license plate, right? We all read the news. This person could be stopped and killed. And so it's what we are talking about, this racial profiling that's actually hurting the constitutional interest of all Americans. So what do we do? I mean, this is a country of democracy. This is a country of liberty. I mean, the only way we can prevent these kind of things from happening is by working together and voice our opinion against this kind of injustice, and also working with, what we have heard the previous panel, with other communities that are victims of the racial profiling. So, I think you can all tell that for Sherry, for myself, when we told our story, when we tell our story, it's not really a fun thing to do. It's not a pleasure to do. It's very painful because we have to relive all these experiences. But on the other hand, we have to do this. We have to help wake up more Chinese American, Asian American, or all Americans to work together to fight the racial profiling. I mean, that's the only way out, because China is going to be strong. There's going to be these geopolitical situations, and the cases like this will happen. And like what Peter has talked about, these current cases, what do we do? I mean, if we all rise up together and fight these injustices, then we can see hope. And I think that's what this country is great about.
Thank you. We're a little short on time. I think we'll entertain one more question. If it could be a quick question for someone to answer, we'll conclude this part. This is what's standing between you and the refreshment.
Okay. Hello. Thank you, everybody, be here. So I'm so glad I can be here and share a story. Actually, 我没有 question. Okay, 我可以用中文跟大家讲吗？ 因为我想大部分想听我这个 story 都是中文。 我尽量在2分钟之内给这个事情给讲完。
OK，2 minutes.
OK，Shirley， 发生的事情在我的身上发生过。这个是我叫孙亮，住在纽约市，我开了一个按摩学校 ，OK， 叫 Academy of Oriental Therapy， 中文叫新东方按摩学校。当我开这个按摩学校的时候呢，我就知道我已经站在风口浪尖上面，因为。 为什么我们中国人的这个按摩现在在美国非常的火热，然后美国冲击了很多美国人的按摩师他们的job，然后他们就想给我们的按摩师用各种各样的方法给打掉，用法律的，现在所以他们设了要很多 license，OK， 那我开了这个学校，为什么我会开这个学校？我有十几个按摩店在 New Jersey and Pennsylvania， 全部在 Major Mall。 一些大的嘛，如果你们在纽约市或 Pennsylvania， 你们会看到我那些店 ，OK， 所以我开了这个学校呢，当初那个纽约市 Labor Department and Education Department 认为我必须要开这个学校，因为所有的还有一分钟时间，请您尽快。好，在13年的10月28号，也是一个 Bright Monday， 然后我在学校。 突然来了7-8部警车，是 U.S. Marshal， 身上全部带了枪，给我们学校一下包围起来了，然后告我们说用他们的题目 ，OK， 用一个联邦的题目，这个联邦呢就是被那些美国按摩师的组织给 support 的，OK， 如果我要说是很长的 story， 但是我现在就说，我通过了一年，花了$600,000 and go to the court, fight with them, okay? 我认为在这个 country, all you have to do, if you think you are right, go fight. All right, agree? 我用了$600,000, 我可以宣布破产, 但是我不认输, 我要去 fight. 我找了最好的律师, 我的一个大律师是$500一小时, 然后和他另外一个律师是$400一小时。我说, don't care money, just fight. 所以 fight 了一年，给这个官司到最后是 settle，OK？ 他们没有给我们学校打掉，他们也没有给我们这个能够发 license 给中国人按摩师的学校打掉，他们也是创的一头破血流，他们花了 800,000 80万，他们花的比我们多。OK， fine， right？ Let's go fight， 这个就是我要讲的 fight。
Thank you。 Okay, thank you so much. That brings up the last part of this. That is, a lot of us don't have $600,000 to spend on lawyers. So I hope the community will support people who will stand up to fight, because each one of us contributing a little bit can do this. I will personally now pledge $2,500 in matching funds. Whatever you come up today, I will match up to $2,500 if you can write a donation to Sherry Chandler at Professor C's Defense Fund. Thank you very much for your session. I'm so sorry we don't have time for any more questions. Thank you.